did actually get a chance to sit down with the players and see what they thought about the tournament so far and their performance, and what they actually think about what's going to happen today in the top eight.
To be through to the final eight, it's always fantastic. It's always a nice feeling when you win, so I'm really happy and I'm looking forward to tomorrow. When preparing for a tournament like this, you kind of have to prepare for the Swiss more than like the really good players. So when I prepared for this, I expected a lot of Zoo, a lot of Druid. So I kind of prepared for that. What motivates most is probably just to get my first win. I've been in the semis and the finals a lot, but I've never found that one win, so I hope this is my tournament, but it always feels like that when you're winning and then eventually you do lose, but eventually I'm hoping it's gonna be my tournament, so maybe this one.
I'm Sixer and I play for Na'Vi. I play Hearthstone to make other people lose. In the Swiss I went 6-1 and my tiebreaker was good enough that I would have even made it if I lost one game with 5-2, so it was like pretty clean for me. But in the groups, I lost my first match, so I had to go from the loser's match to the decider match. So that felt kind of rough to lose. I played against Kalman in the last one of Swiss, and then directly in the first one of groups. And his lineup, say, was like slightly favored against mine. So if he would have lost against Thijs, I would have had like to play against him a third time. I got lucky that Thijs lost and I had a good lineup against Thijs.
There we have it, and his Powder seems quite happy. He went through winning his group quite, like we said, quite quietly, and just plowed on and just took the group. Whereas Sixer had a bit of a rougher matchup, really, and just said he was really glad he didn't have to play Kamlin again because of lineups, and that comes into it really importantly. And speaking of lineups, Powder versus Sixer, and Powder is rocking the Druid, the Aggro Shaman we saw, and the Warrior versus the Paladin, the Warrior, and the Warlock from Sixer. What guys do you think about this lineup?
There's one really important thing that stands out is that Sixer is not playing Druid.
Right. Yeah. Big deal there. I have to say, not playing Druid might be okay in some cases. We've seen a lot of players actually get punished, obviously, for not playing the class. Sixer ended up playing against an opponent who wasn't playing Druid either, I think, at some point. And it's difficult. I feel like that decision not to bring Druid means that you're teching super hard, or at least hoping that your deck lists, all of them, can beat that deck. And based on what Sixer's brought, I'm seeing Patron, I'm seeing probably like a Zoo Warlock and Secret Paladin. I imagine he's there with this lineup to beat the Druids that will be everywhere.
Yeah, I think it's actually Murloc Paladin the Sixer's got.
Oh, the Murloc, that's right.
And if it can have Paladin, which is a great deck against every auto control deck, right? Yeah. Because they're super slow, so you're not really, you know, in a hurry to defend yourself from the onslaught, right? So you can get to the point where you just play turn 10. Anything can happen, deal 20 damage. Turn 11, anything can happen, deal 40 damage.
Yeah. Exactly. It's the second anything that really kills you off in the control matchups. But it is going to be the Patron Warrior of 6-0 versus the Aggro Shaman of Powder. And a lot of these Aggro Shamans have been doing really well. We saw, I think, Ignite had an insane score in Swiss with a Shaman.
Right, 12.
And Powder's been doing the same. I think he 3-0'd his first match in his group and then went 2-0 with it at the start of his second match. So really strong showing here. And even his opening hand seems pretty okay.
Yeah, I feel like Powder here picks up the Trog. He's probably very happy. Picks up, you know, the Flame Juggler as a 2-drop. Pretty happy. God opening for Powder, but 6-0 with the Double Armor Smith, the Fiery War Axe, and also the Dread Corsair to follow it up if he ever needs a taunt. So both players with outstanding starting hands.
Yeah, that's true. Like the Trog, of course, it's a dream for the opening hand. But the Fiery War Axe is just a crusher of dreams.
Yeah. However, the Totem Golem, at the very least, will be able to do work. The only thing that Powder here doesn't want to see is Inner Rage or Cruel Taskmaster finishing off the 3-4 minion.
Yeah, this is the power of the Totem Golem, especially versus Warrior. There's really, other than like a very early execute, there's no easy way to clear this off until turn 4, and you can equip that Death Bite. So it's pretty tough. You're not going to see the Armorsmith just get dropped down in there. Even just passing on the weapon, there's no real point hitting in, especially as he's building up to maybe a Frothing or a Corcoran, and he wants to also drop the Dread Corsair next turn, I imagine.
Right.
Flame Jugger will be really important here. Oh, and it hits the Armorsmith. I feel like even if you're playing a Phase Shaman deck, you need to destroy that Armorsmith as soon as possible, especially when you play against a deck that has access to multiple AoE effects.
Right, they could also use Slam to, you know, start damaging the Totem Golem, finish it off with the Axe, and then you're stuck with a 1-4 Armorsmith you simply can't handle. So this is a very tough start for Bowder, who thought he had a great hand. Looks like it's going to be a little weaker than he expected. He still has decent follow-ups. Once he deals with this board, he's hoping that he's going to be able to finally go through to the face. But little does he know, there's a Frothing, there's a Finley, there's a Corcron, and there's a lot more in the deck that can help Powder clean up the board.
Yeah, the positive thing here for Powder is that he is going to be able to deal with the Armorsmith quite quickly, not this turn, but right. maybe in the next turn. And once that's gone, it's gone, right? You know, there's like both Armorsmiths finished, so he doesn't have to worry about anything too crazy happening later on.
So here's a question. Do you want to play Corcron to get stuff, you know, killed right away? Or do you prefer playing two minions now in order to invest maybe a little bit more on the board, pick up a hero power you like more than this one, like, let's say,
I like Priest. Being proactive here.
That's what I think.
Being proactive is just charging into the minion, because basically you have to think about the Corcron Elite here as a heal spell. You
yeah.
destroy a minion and destroy a second one, because basically the one HP point left for Corcron will mean that another card has to be sacrificed to kill the Corcron Elite as well. So basically you heal two HP points, you get one from Armorsmith, and you still leave a threat on board, which is very important to get the tempo going
right.
for the warrior.
Like this attack here, make sure that his, you know, both his minions are on one health. He's got the option of not attacking into the Corcron and letting it die to the wolf, but he opts to keep the wolf alive and trade away the Flame Juggler instead.
Yeah, I mean, it's generally more valuable, right? It just
right.
has taunt, so, and the other one doesn't, so why not? But yeah, I really like the Corcron play, just because he gains the instant armor as well. And you know what? One armor against this deck, against Aggro Shaman, yeah, it actually makes a huge difference, especially because that was his last Armorsmith. So you may as well just get everything you can out of it. He does drop the Acolyte, really actually needing that card draw, I think, now. Dropping two Frothing Berserkers next turn, it could be all good and well, but he needs definitely needs a weapon now. I think Deathbite is going to be super important in the next couple of turns if he can draw into it. But there's the Doomhammer, which is huge. It's so much damage over a period of time.
Yeah.
So is Powder playing the version with Ancestral Knowledge or Loot Hoarders? I can't remember.
I feel like Ancestral Knowledge would be the one Powder plays. I know that Orange was probably the only player bringing the Loot Hoarders in his deck.
Yeah, I think Powder is playing the Gilding Stalker, though, which was the
right.
Sort of the newish tech that we've seen out of mainly
Flame
the SK
tongue.
Guys.
Yeah.
Well, 3 mana, 2/4/4s that'll get boosted is something not to, you know, ignore. And Powder has 5 mana left, so there are a lot of options. You can use a Crackle to destroy one of the Frothing Berserkers, because you can't really leave those on right now.
Yeah.
This is the situation when you can't really race the warrior, because he's at 28 damage, so I wouldn't be surprised to just see the Crackle and the Argent Horse Rider to finish off both of them, hopefully, right?
I mean, would you trade the Leper Gnome away right away?
No.
Or because, like, if an AoE hits, then the Divine Shield may be more valuable?
That's a good point, actually.
Yeah, we did actually see yesterday in Powder's match where he chose to not play around a swipe in a druid because he just valued having more minions on board and, you know, the hope that the AoE doesn't come down and
loving
just,
this.
You know, repeat the damage from each minion.
I love that play there. He actually decided to tank all the damage knowing full well that he would be fine. But look at that Crackle whiffing completely. And he's going to go into the Whirlwind if there is one.
Well, he's playing somehow around the Whirlwind with the heal right now.
Yeah.
A little bit, yeah.
But it's just one minion that is resistant to that.
Oh,
still no Whirlwind attack,
Boom.
But Dr. Boom on 7 is a huge draw.
Yeah, and also, Zyxo being on 26 health, he can afford to do this. There are a lot of games where the Aggro Shaman at this point has you down to like 6.
Well, this is a really big draw there for Powder. You don't always have a way to enable the Flame Tongue, but this is a full board that's not really been challenge too much by 6-0 yet. He played minions on curve, everything kind of went well, but this is a lot of damage coming in.
I would love to see the boost on the buff from the totem on the taunted up
the wolf,
because the wolf will probably not be at the target of the attack of the bombs, right? Because at 3 HP it doesn't really make sense to attack it,
right, absolutely.
Would have been used to destroy the taunt, and then you still have the buff from the totem on other minions as well.
Well, looks like we're going all in from Powder's side. He's seen two Armorsmiths, right? The only way to gain armor in that deck outside of the hero power is pretty much out of the way.
Yeah, and I like this as well because he's got two taunts up, the Dr. Boom, he's not going to die, right? He has like one or two turns till he's got even close to dying from 6-0 side. So Powder's there just going to use all the damage he can, push face, and hope it's going to be enough. And with the Doomhammer almost guaranteeing doing 4 next turn, because we can't see any taunts in Sixel's hand. This is going to be pretty rough if Sixel can survive this next turn, especially when the boom busts its face, which is probably not really what Sixel wanted to see.
Yeah, he either wants to get the Flame Tongue dead to execute, or have the Boombots kill the Healing Totem, and it does, so at least things are being cleaned up. There's a chance that he picks up the Priest Hero Power after armoring up if he goes for the armor up and Finley. So giving him a little bit more health.
I would love to see that, because it can also be the Druid Hero Power,
right,
which gives you 1 HP. So you have
a Shaman for the taunt. At this point, anything goes, but...
That's like the best worst-case scenario.
Right.
But I think he almost needs to. There's 4 damage already, you know, equipped and available, and he's only on 5. He's going to go up to 7 with the Hero Power, and is he going to go for the Acolyte?
Well, that's interesting. Just...
All right.
He needs to draw 3 damage.
And, well, there
it is. That's 3 damage.
It looks like 3 damage to me.
I'm really surprised that Sixer went for the Acolyte of Pain instead of the Finley.
Yeah.
Because basically, what does he have left in
There's
the deck?
There's 2 chances. Right.
But what does he need from the deck? He played both Alvin Smiths, right?
He's not playing Dread Corsair.
One Dread Corsair was
right.
Gone. And you have basically a card draw in the hands, like a metaphor, right? It's a metaphor card draw from the Sif Finley.
Right.
Because basically get a card.
An extra ability on that turn, right?
Which is basically like a draw. And that draw can give you the 1 HP from the Druid, 2 HP from the Priest Hero Power, right? So there are a lot of options to have a better.
Yeah, and also the thing is, he still had Boom on board, which Powder was never going to kill.
Yeah.
And he had Grom. So he could have just killed him in the next turn if he got like an Inner Rage or anything. So he didn't need to draw into too much when he had so much damage available to him. I felt that going defensive, because the odds on an Aggro Shaman not drawing 3 damage that late into the game when there's still another Lava Burst in the deck, I think another Crackle, he only used 1,
another
right?
Bolt, the Rock Biter.
Exactly.
And even with a Flame Tongue, a Horse Rider works. The thing is, I guess in a list like this one, there's a chance to whiff on Pilot Shredders. We've seen quite a few of those of in the list that we in the tournament. Gilbin Stalker is kind of a whiff in a spot like this. You've got a few draws that would not give the Shaman lethal. But ultimately, yeah, I feel like the safer play of the Finley might have been correct for 6-0.
Yep, but the next match is going to be 6-0 locking in his Zoo versus Powder's Shaman again, because this is Last Hero Standing as well. So if you win with a deck, you hold on to it. And if you lose, you actually lose the ability to play that deck in this series.
Yeah, but this is very difficult for 6-0, because now the Patron Warrior is out of the way. And Zoo is not exactly the deck you want to run with against an Aggro Shaman.
I feel like you actually want to run Zoo into the Aggro.
Sure, if you get the good taunts, you're good, because you keep tempoing him out. But the type of list that this Aggro Shaman is playing has more minions. I feel it's playing a lot more for board control than the older list.
That's a good point.
Yep.
So it does make the, Zeus powerful board control a little less effective.
Yep. So the opening hand for 6-0 looks not great. I was going to say it's okay, because the egg and the peddler are good openings, and he has the Augur. So it's okay. It's not terrible, but it's definitely not a perfect opening whatsoever. Oh.
Now Powder's got to figure out, well, is there a PO in that hand? Can I unstealth my minions?
You have to. I don't think you can actually
wait.
Well, what's interesting here is as well, I think yesterday I was talking to Powder about this deck, and he said the amount of times he's gone turn 2 onto the Flamethrower Totem, onto the 1 minion he played turn 1, and just go face and just one off the back of that, because then it gives your opponent 2 minions they have to deal with. They have to deal with the minion, and then the Flamethrower Totem is going to provide so much of a threat that it just slows their opponent down a lot, and then they can just build on that. So even though the Flame Juggler like just looks like the more obvious play here, it wouldn't surprise me too much if he played the Flame Tongue and just like hit him in the face.
Yeah, I mean, the upside of the... And the attempt at clearing out this board there, this better hit for 4 and the whiff. That was insanely ballsy.
To be honest, I didn't like that decision at all.
I feel like that might have been a bit of an overcommitment.
It was so safe.
Right.
That it was so risky in the process.
That's exactly it. Yeah.
If you lose that that Crackle, which is of course a 25% roll, but if you lose that Crackle, you basically threw the entire game, because you enable your opponent's Spider immediately, giving him charge, basically.
Yep.
And buys your opponent time as well. It gives you overload, and you lose card advantage.
And this is even worse, with the Soul Fire being picked up by Peddler. Because the 4-1 will not die unless the Flame Juggler decides to hit the perfect target.
Unless the Flame Juggler decides that he's going to hit.
I'm going to be useful.
Does he decide? Yeah. Oh, of course he does.
Oh, why would he not?
Everything as planned.
No drawback. That was all expected.
I think what was really strange about Powder's play there was his two minions were on if he played the Flame Jugger that previous turn, were on 3 health. So his opponent would need a Power Overwhelming or double abusive to actually kill the minion.
Which is why I thought he would let it live, right? Like the odds of the opponent having exactly what he needed, it would have had to be a Peddler into Pio or just a straight up Power Overwhelming. And if it's used this early, you still have the Crackle to do exactly what you did.
Yeah. A very good point.
Yeah, and the Finley does come down this turn, I think mainly because he wants to not be overloaded for the Doomhammer, because you're trying to equip Doomhammer as soon as possible, especially in this matchup where actually trading against
the Zinni. I suspect we'll still see it, though.
I think what Powder was looking for was the ability to deal 1 damage to get rid of that 3-1 minion.
Yeah, well, let's hope for him that the Feral Spirit is going to be justified here. Yep. What I like about this is that even if you end up losing one of the Wolves to the 3-1, because you still have 2 open mana with a Rock Biter, you're able to deal with most of what the Zoo would try to do. Well, never mind. That's a Lightning Storm requirement.
No one plays Lightning Storms anymore, unfortunately. Yep. I love the Phase Shaman version with the Elemental Destructions, to be honest.
Yeah, 6-0 is the one I think that I saw play it first in Insomnia. In fact, last time I saw this.
Yeah, it's really good as well because at the time, the idea is it's actually a comeback mechanism that works because you still play Ancestral Knowledge, so you can still draw into cards late game and then push through that. And you still run Lava Shock, which just removes all that overload as well. So it seems pretty good. But at the moment, after that implosion, Powder's just going to try and work on cleaning this board up. And he just drops the Flame Tongue because why not at this point? He just needs to play another minion.
So I would say that the Giant would be insanely good to drop this turn if he would still have one of the Defender Vargas in his hand.
It's not still a very good play, though, given that the Shaman does not run any hexes. You've seen a Crackle that can technically, in some cases, roll high, just whiff. And so the amount of cards that will be needed for Powder to use to deal with this Giant is too many.
Look at that. It's turn 6, and the Warlock is at 30 HP.
Yeah. Yep.
Everything because of that attack and crackle into the egg.
I feel like Powder, we talked about this before, right? The way that he plays safe sometimes can be a bit of an issue. So I feel like Powder's line of play, even though the reasoning behind it, I understand. Like, the potential gain was good. If it worked, it was insanely powerful because you didn't lose your 2-3. There's no Power Overwhelming target ever. But that 25% chance to lose the game straight up is maybe not making this gamble worth it.
I understand what you're saying, but I think the Shaman is just a different archetype.
Right.
And if a card deals damage once, it's already done its job.
Yeah, you have to do that,
than, right? It's different than Zoo, because basically what Powder was trying to do is to play the Zoo's game.
And with his own deck, yeah.
Yes, and you have a deck that is actually way worse than Zoo in this regard, right?
Absolutely.
So why wouldn't you just want to stick to your own strategy and deal the damage and go for the win as soon as possible, because you can't really outrun Zoo when it comes to board.
You can't outrun, yes, that's true.
Yep, and this Voidwalker is actually going to be really rough. I mean, he's in a rough position anyway, regardless, but he can't even easily take it down. Well, it's like the Rock Biter on it.
Horse Rider.
You take too much damage, though.
But you die.
Exactly.
There's still lethal on board.
Yep, so 6-0 does even it up with his Zoo and removes Powder Shaman from the set here. And it's gonna be a tough one for Powder, I think, because Zoo's just a pretty overall just solid deck, and it's obviously why a lot of players are bringing it to the air.
Right. I don't know. I feel like this game was thrown out the window by Powder.
Yes, it was. In my opinion, it was. Powder was playing just switch the gear in backwards.
Backwards, yeah. I think, you were alluding to the fact that that Crackle was not correct. And I feel like there were many lines of play you could have taken past this point to still keep that Crackle value for versatility purposes and get away with a little bit more flexibility in the future. Now, we see Powder bringing out the Control Warrior against the Zoo. How is the matchup nowadays?
With the Deathlords, that's quite different. Because the value from Deathlord will be insane good if there will be no egg into PO, an example. So the Deathlord will be giving Powder a lot of time to develop the board as well. And Warrior is in general one of the class, one of the classes that can benefit from the execute and the death load really heavily. So he has a really insane opening hand, to be honest.
Yeah, the opening hand's really good from Powder. Just even, but like you said, just getting off an early execute is fine just to slow the Zoo player down, because your real aim here is to actually just clear the board and just keep the Zoo's board empty, and then they can just never really do anything. Cards like Power Overwhelming, Abusive Sergeant, can't really get any work done if there's no minions to proc off them.
Right.
It even draws into a Bash as well, which is just another like really good removal card whilst putting the Warrior further out of range of the Zoo burst potential.
Yeah, you look at Garrosh there, like he's in flames. 500 wins out of that Warrior for Powder, and this hand is basically the trademark. Yeah, I can't lose this ever again.
Yeah, and the good thing about Deathlord, especially versus Zoo, is that one of the like easy answers to a Deathlord, depending on what deck you're playing, is like just Owl it and ignore it. But then the 2/8 is going to trade really well against all the smaller Zoo minions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, now I have to wonder though how different is maybe the matchup when you're playing a Sea Giant version that 6-0 has. There are big minions where you demand an execute.
Or a big game hunter, that's a
that's true, that's yeah. Right. You do give them a target for that. There's probably a Mal'Ganis somewhere deep in that deck if he plays Void Callers.
Is it with the Sea Giants?
No, I'm asking because we saw a list that was running like a mix of the Sea Giant Mal'Ganis in the tournament.
Yeah, I think when you see the Bran and the Gormok, it's probably not got any demons in 6-0's specific list.
Right.
I really like what 6-0 just did with the Defender of Argos because he didn't toned up the Hunted Creeper. And why? The reason why is that the Hunted Creeper was played first before the weapon. So the weapon Death Rattle would be triggered after the Death Rattle from the Hunted Creeper if it would be attacked. So in the process, both 1/1s would have been killed with a whirlwind effect from the Death Spite. So I really like protecting the Hunted Creeper right now.
Yeah, Powder does have an option if he really wants to slam the Creeper and then clear off that, but he still wouldn't kill the 2/3 anyway with the weapon attack. So definitely not worthwhile. And I like just the Deathlord is just safe. Hold on to the weapon.
Look
why
at this
not?
Gormok.
Look at this Bran Bronze Beard with double Surgeons.
I mean,
do you want to play the Wind? That's the problem. That's the only problem.
You could play just the Gormok, right?
Yeah.
The abusive Gormok for 4, and then you still have a really clean trade. You played into the Wind a little bit. If there's a bash and a slam,
it's
you're in
come
trouble.
Out of Deathlord.
Oh goodness, that execute finds the target.
That's actually not bad for Powder. When you think about it, there's a bash.
There's a slam.
And
you can
bash the Gormok, attack into the 2/2 with the taunt, and then execute 7/7.
I think you leave the spider alive. That's all that stays up. Basically.
Yes, exactly.
That is essentially all.
I think the Bran Bronze Beard will bring a lot of value to the table when a single Dark Peddler will be just, you know, showing up.
That's true. It will prevent 6-0 from having to pay for the life tap. So I do like that. It'll give him a little bit more card draw out of what otherwise looks a little boring.
Yeah, that Deathlord was nuts though, because at first as 6-0 he would have been like, oh, a free 7/7, not bad, but when Powder can instantly just answer the whole board, that's got to be a little bit demoralizing there.
Yeah, but right now there's no immediate, like there's no easy answer to this entire board. So for now, Powder is gonna have to try to scramble to deal with this Bran, and he wants to deal with Bran.
Slam bash.
Slam bash, or you develop just a card. But I like the slam bash way too much not to put it on the board.
Yeah, although I think like because there's not much actual damage on the board, even though Bran is a threat, I kind of like just dropping just a card here. You just get it down straight away. You're nowhere even close to dying next turn. And then against Zoo especially, because he's got a follow-up of, he's got weapons, he's got slam, bash, execute. He follows up by clearing or trying to clear the board next turn, and then he just cashes in on that 4 armor every single turn. And if you can clear the board as well versus Zoo, they're never going to be able to burst you down.
To be honest, I agree with your reasoning. If there would be any other creature than Bran Bronzebeard, I would just instantly slam the Justicar. But when I see Bran Bronzebeard, I'm like, no, I can't really allow Zoo to bank on those double battle cries.
Right.
Because a single Dark Peddler, a single Defender of Argos, a single Abuser Sergeant brings so much like immediate effect on the board. It's really huge.
Well, it just enhances what Zoo is already good at, right? All the trading up, the extra additional buffs and damage. Bran Bronzebeard literally doubles them all. So I understand that he is a huge threat, and he's going to just play Corruption. And this is pretty nice, as unless he kills the being able to kill the Voidwalker, this 6/3 is just going to run into the 1/3 Voidwalker and then just die off the turn after.
Yeah, very good hand though for Powder. Again, that Justicar will pay off in the long term. But for now, I don't think he's going to get too many opportunities to just armor up, right? So he's going to have to use his mana almost fully just to clean up everything.
Oh, the weapon and Belcher seems okay.
Yeah.
I like that.
Weapon into the 1-3, use the 6-3 to kill off Bran and the Belcher, like you said. And what's really good is the weapon's going to be there next turn as well. And you know there's going to be a use for it against Zoo no matter what.
Still, look at that armor up that he got from Justicar. Not coming in handy just yet. And with the amount of pressure that 6-0 can put together in the next few turns, assuming he had a PO of his own that wasn't from... that he picked up a Peddler PO, that is, he would have a lot more damage this turn.
That was actually a huge roll, because you don't have to enable your egg, so you still have an option to play around draw. This is a huge roll.
And revenge is a huge draw.
Not bad.
not bad at all.
Seems good. So now you pretty much just did. I mean, he could attack into the egg, revenge, and execute, and just remove like.
You attack the egg, yeah. He could also
just attack the creeper and then just leave the egg on the board. He doesn't even have brawl, so why is he bothered about the egg at the moment?
Imagine that would have been whirlwind. You just play.
Whirlwind Dr. Boom. Yeah.
This is the
power to hell.
This is the power of the difference between one mana and two mana. It doesn't sound like much because, like, what's the difference between 4 and 5, right?
Right.
But between 1 and 2, there's a huge, huge difference when it comes to squeezing those cards together in a turn.
Yeah, and especially in a control deck, you normally have the space to, you know, like, just squeeze in those, you know, one mana cards. So I agree, it's pretty huge, but the revenge could have clicked, like, you know, later on if he was at lower health. Could have sweeped a board of 3 health minions, so that's the trade-off you get for the extra mana there.
Yeah, the revenge I think was key, because that turn looked a little bit difficult to weave in a hero power on, but because of the revenge, he was able to do a lot more work with a little less mana. And now he's going to get 4 armor every single turn pretty much past this point.
The problem is 2 Sea Giants for almost 0 mana.
Yeah, these boom bots are going to have to do their fair share of work, and that should negate at least one of them. We'll see how 6-0 decides to play this turn. The implosion is very appealing.
And you don't want to overextend with both giants.
Right, and haven't seen a brawl.
Yes, you didn't even see a brawl, but at the same time, you didn't see a big Kim Hunter, and you only saw 1 execute.
Yep.
No shield slams.
Yes, that's right.
And another implosion for 4 damage.
Now, the problem is if you want to play any giant, you have to at least lose a minion, right? So the option of going for PO, like if you power overwhelm the egg to kill Dr. Boom, then you're overextending into brawl very heavily.
Yeah, and also, this is also where the sort of sea giant maths comes into play as well, because you think, oh, okay, well, I'll just trade the 2-1 away into a 1-1 or something, and then the boom bot kills another minion, and suddenly the sea giants cost more, and it's like, you know, it can all go wrong. This is the safe play, just power overwhelming, clear off Dr. Boom, even though it was a lot of overkill, but it just guarantees easy sea giant with still a full board, and there is a shield slam. Wow.
Another minion to stop the aggression from 6-0.
So, do you actually prefer the trade execute here because you can guarantee and being able to use execute? Or although he has slam,
might
right?
Lose armor.
So you go shield slam for the other reason that you can't guarantee armor next turn.
Well, you might still be able to, you know, slam execute for the draw. It's not half bad.
To be honest, I would rather just keep the bombs alive this turn even.
Yeah, I was deciding to choose that slam wasn't in his hand. So that's changed it a little bit. He does just go for the shield slam to remove it, and he has slam execute for the next giant as well. So that's going to be huge. And is he going to trade?
I don't like those trades. I would love to
see this could be a bit clunky.
Belcher dropped on the board and deal 2 damage to your opponent's face, because then he has to trade with the Belcher first. Your bombs still will have value next turn to get you the execute going on, and you know,
less imps to hit with them.
Less imps to hit. Yeah. Exactly.
And also he just saw a power overwhelming, which is the scary thing. When there's an imp on the board, you play Belcher and they just go PO, kill it. You're like, oh, okay, that's a little bit rough. But he did just see a power overwhelming. And now on 6-0's hand there is an owl, Defender of Argus, and he can play the Sea Giant as well.
Yeah, kind of liking this play here from 6-0. He's like, you know what, at some point you're gonna have brawl, and this is the turn where you need it.
Yeah.
If you don't have it, I might be able to take over this game.
But we can see the Powder's going to be still, I think, in a good position. Ooh, the one hit was kind of kind of weird there. Didn't summon additional token, but the one hit still not doing too much that in Gang Boss. But he does have the Slam Execute, which is huge. Removes the second Sea Giant, and they're one of the only major threats left in the deck.
Yeah, no Brawl left. But the Sylvanas is definitely not a bad draw here. Yeah. Even if there's no Brawl, you still have some insurance because the damage is not that high. It's only 4, 6, 8, 10 damage when you think about it. Now decreased to 8. And you will gain 4 HP each turn now. That seems fine.
Yeah. Yeah.
It doesn't feel bad for
Powder. And also, none of these minions stick out as like too powerful, but if he stole any of these, probably minus the Owl, it's probably feeling pretty okay. The Gang Boss is going to get some work done. The 2-3 Argus can get some work done, and the egg on board just to sort of, you know, reverse the Brawl mechanic with the egg.
Well, this is looking a bit scary, though, I'll be honest with you. Like, this is... Like, this Leroy Jenkins does not look like very much. But that's a lot of damage that could be coming out of nowhere for Powder. If he doesn't expect it, which probably he doesn't, it could be a problem. You know, now, one thing to note is that there's a lethal with like an AoE effect, right?
Yeah, there's lethal with a slam, with a shield slam, with a bash, and not with this one. Wow, that was actually almost it.
Yeah, there was a chance that any AoE effect would kill the Imp and then the Gore Howl goes face, like the 7 damage that it is. Here, there's probably a good argument to be made for playing Grom and trading away Sylvanas.
Yeah,
to steal a minion.
Yeah, yeah, I like Grom here because you still armor up, so you gain the 4 armor, you kill 2 minions, and Sylvanas steals a third. So this just removes as much threat as possible, whereas Gore Howl, although would be good over a few turns, he probably doesn't really want to take the damage at the moment.
I mean, the Gore Howl is just a 7 damage burst. It's basically a Rio and Jenkins for Warrior in this situation.
Yeah.
So keeping it in the hand when you already showed the Grommash on board is basically like a surprise factor that your opponent can use the 7 damage in the face and finish off the game.
And you never expect it, really. So everyone's so used to Gore Howl doing like so efficient trades with minions, and then it comes out of nowhere and just hits you for 7 is really rough. And this is going to be fairly important. There's still a lot of decent targets for Sylvanas to steal. But I think if you got something like the Juggler or the Gang Boss, it's going to be pretty good.
He's considering, do I want to play for value, go face? Because if I go face, there's only 13 on board. And the odds of, you know, the damage piling up to the point where I die here is very slim.
And it just gives, unless there's a taunt, it's just lethal next turn just from hand.
Right.
With the Gore Howl, so. And I think he's seen both Argus now?
Yep.
Yeah, I think both
have been played. So there's maybe a Voidwalker from Peddler number 2, but that's about it.
But he saw only one PO, and he didn't see a single Doomguard yet. That was kind of risky.
Well, that deck doesn't tend to run Doomguards, but you might be worried about Leroy. Yeah. You may be very worried about Leroy Jenkins.
Xixa was showing Leroy yesterday, so Powder seems to be shifting those gears really often. Sometimes with the aggressive deck, he's being overly safe.
And the other way around.
Yeah, and the other way around with the deck that should be overly safe, right? So, interesting, because still, like, Xixa was already low on health. So, interesting.
Yeah, I think the thing as well with Powder, though, is even with Leroy power overwhelming, would he have needed still the juggles to hit?
No, that was enough.
Would have been 10.
No, you were a little shy.
Yeah.
Because you were missing...
22.
Actually, that was 23 exactly, right?
PO and Leroy was exactly enough.
Oh, was it? Oh, okay.
23 specifically, I think, to hit the armor count.
And that's about it.
Yep, that's going to be it. He does snipe off the Grom for the style points there, but Powder's actually just going to go, oh, and there's a Brawl. A little bit late, but hey-ho, he's going
to put Gore Howl. Yeah, but Xixo is demolished morally right now.
Yeah, it's a very rough... you don't want to go up against Control Warrior, just generally speaking, and when you don't have Druid, you just don't want to go up against.
But he has Murloc piled in.
Right.
It's actually an insanely good matchup versus Control Warrior.
But then
it depends.
Druid is left against the Paladin.
Yeah, that's going to be the rough game. Yeah.
Good luck.
Yeah, that's going to be the rough game, but I think like Paladin has a pretty good matchup versus Control Warrior because a lot of the time, you almost guaranteed the game is going to go late and you can draw through most of your deck. You just play the first anything, and it's not the first one just does like, you know, maybe 20 damage, 15 damage, whatever, but it's the second one that does like ludicrous amounts of damage.
Right.
And unless the warrior gets a really early True Heart and then stacks up like a stupid amount of armor, then you're feeling pretty good as this Paladin.
I would say that Powder should even hard mulligan.
Yeah.
For the Justicar.
No doubt. No doubt in my mind. And an ooze in Sixo's deck is going to be able to, I guess, nullify some of that damage coming in from weapons if he ever needs to heal for more than he already does. And Powder just keeps the weapons. Is he aware that Sixo's playing Murloc Valley?
He'll definitely be aware, and he'll probably be aware of the ooze as well, because this 6-0's game, he did play an ooze on stream.
Right.
And I have no doubt that Powder and also the rest of his team have not really researched this matchup and worked out exactly what 6-0's got in his list. He did get the Justicar.
Yeah, this is basically the card that Powder was looking for. I imagine he didn't hard mulligan for it, surprisingly. One of the things as well that is a bit aggravating when you're playing Warrior in a spot like this is the death by a thousand cuts that the little 1-1s can represent. Dudes just hitting you for one every turn, stacking up the damage. It gets a little frustrating.
Yeah, and also what's a really interesting nuance of this deck is, there we go, you're just playing War Leader as a 3-3. If it attacks, fantastic, it's attacked. If it gets killed, fine, because you just bank it for anything later. So anything that this 3-3 does is just an instant benefit for 6-0.
Right, one of the things as well that I tend to see in matchups like these is Paladins will be a little greedier with their War Leaders and play them only when they find a blue kill. Yep. On that one turn to buff the damage immediately. Because yes, playing the War Leader on tempo against Warrior might feel good since you have to answer it. But very often, if they have the answer, you're missing out on some more potential damage. And if they stack up too much armor, that's your win condition out the window.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Oh, okay, so my role here will be just remembering which Warlocks died.
Okay.
Right. Damage. I like that.
We'll just hand Lothar a notepad and he'll just go quiet for a few minutes while he's right, one War Leader, done.
Yeah.
And this is also something 6-0 has to remember as well. I've no doubt he's very proficient at doing this. If you take a deck like this to a tournament, you do have to count those Murlocs and remember exactly what you've played. But
not only 6-0, Powder has to be aware
of that
as
well. Yeah, that's
very true. Powder, even more importantly, I think that Powder has to be more aware than 6-0.
Yeah.
Because he needs to be on top of on top of that damage all the time.
Yeah, he's gonna be a little scared there because he saw the Justicar come out exactly on curve. Not being a coin in Powder's hand means this is basically the earliest it can come out.
Yep.
And that's very dangerous. And now I think at this point Powder has to start trying to pile up as much health as possible.
You have to use the hero power now every single turn. And I like the bash, you still have two minions that are just chipping off the small amount of HP, but that's sometimes enough. You just chip off the slow game, you ramp up with the armor, and that's about it what you need.
Because one of the ways that the Murloc Paladin deck can actually fail is when they're forced into a heal they don't want to do.
Yeah.
If you get an uncomfortable, because Lay on Hands, it's an amazing card. 8 mana, draw 3 cards. A lot of the time as a Murloc Paladin, you can Lay on Hands on 28 health because
right.
You want the card draw. But when you're forced to Lay on Hands in an uncomfortable position where that's your whole turn, you do nothing else, that's when you can really just push them from Powder's point of view and just really make every turn as awkward as possible for him.
Yeah. So the Aldor having already been used on the Justicar means the second one will need to find a better target. And again, Lay on Hands.
Yep, there we go.
20 or 26, he will overheal a little bit. Plus, given the amount of cards in hand, he will probably lose one from the top. Hopefully for him, it's not a Murloc that he needs.
Yep, this is huge. If he burns old Murkai.
Or Bluegill, even.
That's basically game.
But he's almost instantly not going to win the game.
Cross your fingers, 6-0. This is your card draw. This is the one that matters the most. Solemn Vigil burning away.
Oh, you can see 6-0. Oh my god.
Is he okay?
And
he
loses. Okay. That was
He's fine. Yeah.
Yes.
All right.
I don't think that was a correct decision this turn.
It felt a bit early. I think he might have miscounted the amount of cards left in his hand.
I think one of the issues there is I understand needing to take the risk, but I don't think he needed to take the risk that turn.
Right.
That's the problem, because if that was old Murkai, the game just ends.
For Powder, though, the plan is Brawl for the first. Anything can happen. You need to survive it, of course. So you need to ramp up the armor. Yep. But you need to survive the first. Anything can happen. Deal with the board, because you have to deal with it anyway, and count your opponent. That the other opponent doesn't have the second anything can happen, and still ramp up with the armors. For now, we had two War Leaders gone, and that's about it. So there's no threat so far.
Yeah.
Yeah, no damage coming in for the time being. Powder will see it coming from a mile away anyway. It'll be advertised with the the blue kill having to be played prior, the Murkai having to be played prior.
Exactly. I mean, as you just said, Lothar, with the... there's an old Murkai. It is actually going to be played, which is important.
Yeah.
But the second this card is played, Powder's going to be right, okay, so there's one old Murkai, two War Leaders, that's X damage. But without the Charge Murlocs, he's still feeling pretty safe. Like,
yeah,
he's very flagged when you're going to play the Anafin, and he needs to play around that health. And he still has plenty of answers. He's got two weapons. He's got the Revenge Shield Slam. He's got Bash to gain even more armor, and an easy execute if he wants to just remove this Murkai.
So well, for now, the single Murkai will be dealing 8 damage. For now. Yep. Because the double buff from the Wall Eater, and then the...
plus 2 from the Murkai.
Yes, and the 2 from the Murkai. With just the 3 minions,
yep,
that's 8 damage. But a single auto Blue-Gull Warrior will ramp up the damage by 7.
Yeah. One of the problems as well is, the way this Paladin deck can actually whiff is if those Blue-Gull Warriors are bottom of the deck. Because then it just might be too late. You know, it might just take too long to get to it, and their powder
just
would be too much.
Bar.
Exactly, with just a card 6, you've just been too much of a good position to make that happen. And drawing into a heal bot is really not great for 6. So at the moment, he's, if you look at his whole hand, he can clear off the Death Bite with the Ooze, which seems okay. But the rest of his follow-up is non-existent. And what I really like as well from Powder is he isn't rushing this Dr. Boom, because what Dr. Boom does this turn, there you go, is actually give him a good one of those big blowout AoE turns that Paladin can do with a quality with either Consecrate or Wild Pyro to just wipe a whole board.
Correct.
Yeah, when you've seen 2 Aldors as well, the Dr. Boom must look a little bit more appealing. You might think, yeah, this might just live. We've seen Inequality, I've seen 2 Aldors. I don't think this deck is going to be stacking Humilities necessarily. Some of the older versions were trying to run, you know, a heavy anti, you know, Keeper of Old Demons, Humility, Aldors, like trying to very control, minion control route, and then card draw eventually became the norm.
Yeah, and even Humility, we actually saw from Amnesiac, I believe,
right,
in his deck from the NA Championship.
Pretty
so
good.
It's definitely a possibility, and there's a lot of different ways this deck can be built, which makes it super interesting. I kind of like the full cycle version myself.
Yeah.
I'm just going to draw my whole deck every single game, and then you have to deal with it. But the boom does come down on much like safer board and Humility. There we go.
There we go. That's the pickup that 6-0 wanted, though, for real. That is the one.
Is it needed that much? I mean, you still have the equality.
Equality, yeah. I could see that. So
look,
you lay on hands.
Lay on hands.
He's going to tank the boom bot. Tank that boom bot.
Heal for 1, draw 3 cards.
Good. I guess Doomsayer in a spot like this is actually forcing this Dr. Boom to wait before it deals damage to face.
Yeah, well, also, this is one of the combos you actually do, and why Humility is actually in the deck as well. It can be used on its own just to reduce the damage, but one of the plays is when a big minion comes out, you Humility and Doomsayer.
Yeah.
And then you say, well, you can't really answer with what's on the board, and then you can't play any more minions unless you can directly deal with this Doomsayer this turn.
Just to wait for the day that people play Humility with Enter the Colosseum.
Oh.
You enter the Colosseum
the
and then you Humility whatever's left, and it's like, yeah, you have a 1 attack minion, congratulations.
Good work.
You've done nothing. And the Ooze, ironically, will die to a weapon.
Will it?
I imagine so. But
I think like valuing the free HP is more.
Okay, I could see that.
And you play around a Solemn Vigil as well.
You're right.
Yeah, and I think what this is doing is really showing Powder's understanding of this matchup, in where he's actually just his first thing he's doing every single turn before
armor
anything
up.
Else happens is armor up.
He missed
every
one of them.
Yeah, exactly.
That was on
when
the Dr. Boom
played
turn.
The Dr. Boom. And
I was wondering on that turn if perhaps maybe just waiting for the Dr. Boom since there's no rush was correct, but. With the amount of health he's got, he still needs to go quite a long way before he's safe from the double anything.
And this is something, actually, the situation 6-0's in now is one of those awkward ones where he has card draw, but his hand is so full that it's a little bit risky, you know, like drawing. If he drew into more cards that he couldn't really play that turn or make work, it would have been a bit rough. But he did get one of those Blue-Gull Warriors, which is really important now. They're pretty much the only cards he's looking for.
Not a 5 armor. This is stacking really fast. There's a Thrustable Champion in the Paladin deck, right?
Yes.
We haven't seen any, but
they normally
yes,
run
2
as a fairly standard build.
Another card draw, another
Brawl.
Oh,
the second Brawl as well.
Well, now he needs just to survive both anything can happen.
Yeah.
But I mean, if you survive both and you have Brawls for both, then...
And that's why the second Brawl is super important.
And this is also why Gorehole is so important. Because it will be effective for both anything.
Exactly, yeah. He can actually just, now he has the tools to deal with both anythings, he just has to make sure he survives the initial wave of attack from each one. But he's still got more time. He's still not seen these Blue-Gull Warriors yet.
Yeah.
You know, there is one in hand that we can see, but 6-0 has to play it before the anything can draw it out of the graveyard.
All right, looks like it's going to be coming out. So the hope here is that he's going to get recurrent damage from this, given that the board is cleaned up. Like, if you can get that blue gill to do any more work with the second one coming up, you can basically win the game. I feel like the amount of armor is not quite up there yet for the double anything, but it's about to get even higher.
Yeah, I like the Harrison now. You just remove the weapon. That's also 4 damage, which is basically plus 4 armor.
Right,
yeah,
exactly.
And also, like, the heal he doesn't care about. The Paladin itself just doesn't matter in any way, shape, or form here for the Powder here. But the removal of the damage to himself is super important. And also, one of the key cards that can mess up in it, anything turn is that Sludge Belcher, because that's just so awkward to trade into. You have to use all of your mana to play the anything. So it's not like you can play anything and then Owl.
Right.
Sludge Belcher, ignore it. You have to run at least 2 minions in to kill both parts of the Sludge Belcher, and that reduces the damage so much from that combo piece.
23 times. That's how many times was that Blue Water kill?
Overkill, yeah, it died. It has 23 deaths at this point.
First anything can happen.
Whoa,
I'm
without the
surprised.
Second Blue Gill. Didn't wait for the second Blue Gill Warrior.
I'm really surprised by that.
Is that a mistake, well, Sixo?
Wait, let's count the damage, because he will have 2 Wall Leaders and a Murkai and a Blue Gill Warrior. So second anything can happen, which is completely randomized.
He has to get...
So he would have to get 2 Murkais and 2 Blue Gill Warriors and 3 Wall Leaders. That's the perfect scenario. In that scenario, you deal, let's count the damage. So you have 3 charge minions, this is 6 damage.
6 damage right away.
Then you have 7 Murlocs in play from 2 Murkais, that's 14.
Yep.
So you have 20. Then you have 3 charge minions, which
plus
is plus 4.
3 Wall Leaders, right?
3 Wall Leaders, plus 6. So that's 18.
Yeah, he would actually have...
So that's 38.
Yeah, that's 38 damage. So it's still very... He needs to find... I'm surprised he didn't wait for the second Blue Gill.
I think one of the problems is, if the Blue... Although he is edging towards the bottom of his deck, if the Blue Gill's the last minion he draws, like the last card, did he think, oh, well, maybe that's too late, and the Warrior was stacking up so much armor.
I can imagine.
Gives more turns for the Warrior to play cards like Belcher, Shield Maidens, maybe another Shield Block, or something like that to really stack it up. So he's going to play the Shield Maiden there. He doesn't play the Brawl to clear the board, so yeah, you just reduce it down.
Well, he guarantees
one,
a single Blue Gill to stay alive on this spot, though, from the
oh my God.
He's going to have a charge main
leaders,
for sure.
Right?
He needs to find War Leaders way more than he wants. That is not quite...
That's not
one-off?
That's one-off.
Oh,
that's
wow.
One-off. That's
it's not over. Choose our champion top deck could still... Oh, never mind.
That's like, I'm really surprised. How can you do that move without counting the damage first? I'm really surprised.
Well, let's see it though. Let's see what happens past this point.
Yeah, so what needs to happen now is Powder needs to armor up because Consecrate's
no, no,
a card.
I think you can't really armor up. You need to play Belcher.
Yeah, but
well,
you're
dead
not
to
playing
Consecrate,
around Consecrate,
right?
Yeah, but you have to choose. Are you playing around a weapon? Are you playing around? Actually,
no, we play armor up with armor.
Yeah,
yeah. If he armors up,
correct.
Doesn't die
armor
to
up
any
is
card.
Way better, and yep. Just Deathlord sees the deal.
There we go.
Correct.
The armor up 3 drop should do it. And now, 6-0,
yep.
Equality, Pyro, True Silver. Oh,
oh
goodness.
My God.
You are serious.
Wow.
The true
off the
Silver
top.
With the damage to finish off Bowder.
Wow.
Unbelievable.
That's the other Merlot.
That was the only card that was actually
yes.
in the game right now.
That was it.
And there was only one in the deck.
One True Silver left.
Wow.
With that Consec could take it.
That was very, very risky from 6-0. Actually being one off, although he did have the Consecrate with the armor up going for 4 and not having a way to win after that was insane.
If he couldn't top deck this
Russell, yeah,
that was end of
yeah,
the
game. Lost, yeah. Yeah.
Well, wow. I'll say it. Pretty risky. Anything from 6-0, almost to the point of being a misplay. But maybe it was actually just, as you said, you know, wondering whether or not he'd ever be able to get to that Blue Gill before the armor stacked up to perhaps 50.
Well, and judging by his reaction after the second anything can happen, he was surprised that he's not killing his opponent.
Yeah.
He looked surprised, genuinely.
Yes. So I think he miscounted.
And also, one of the problems as well is each player only gets a certain amount of time on their turn, and as you were doing then, Lothar, trying to work out every single outcome of the potential second anything was actually quite difficult to work out potential damage in a short period of time. So definitely a rough one, and now 6-0 has his Paladin again versus the Druid list from Powder. And this is another SK list, I believe, as we saw the Spectral Knights.
I totally forgot that this is the list with the Flame Juggler.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the Spectral Knights being back.
And the
Violet Sky Golem.
Sky Golem, that's the way. I was going to say Shredder, and I was like, that's not the name of that.
It's not as overpowered.
It's the big Shredder.
Yeah. Well, so the Doomsayer here could be played for tempo. I imagine it will happen, but with the Innervate Keeper, that's the perfect answer to deal with this, and it leaves you in command if you really want to take it.
Is the Innervate Keeper really?
It's good. You keep the Mana Crystal, right? So you have.
That's true.
You got the Wild Growth.
And also, he has a lot of options as well. He's got really good follow-up with multiple minions. And at the moment, this is one way this deck, because this is a very strange Druid deck to start off with. It plays a really weird selection of minions. But sometimes you're just too fast for the Paladin as well. You can actually just be so aggressive that they don't have the mana or the time to draw into the answers quick enough to wipe the board.
But you play double combo, right?
Yeah. You kind of have to.
Yeah, you still chuck in that.
Well, nice job, Doomsayer. You may not have brought up the end, but at least you killed. You tanked one damage.
Yeah, that's always something. You can tank up a Sylvanas as well if there's a Sylvanas in the Druid deck.
Boom bots.
Murkai.
Okay, well, so, you know, for all the tough Doomsayer into Keeper of the Grove that Sixto might have to deal with, he still has, you know, a decent hand to counter what the Druids are coming out with.
Yep, and he does actually, which is pretty important, reduce the Mana Crystal back down to 4. As Druid's it's 5 like, drop, you don't want to see a Druid of the Claw that turn if you can afford it. Mm-hmm. And he does just follow up with the Raptor instead, which is still pretty good. It's another durable minion that isn't going to just straight up die to a flat Consecrate. It will summon another minion afterwards, even though it is only a 1 drop. It's better than nothing, because you do just need to pressure the Paladin early and try and just really finish the game before you can get the big combos going.
Well, 6-0 is going to play for the board here. He's going to develop the 3-3 Murloc alongside Hero Power. He's got the Equality Consecration in case the board is, you know, there's no more Death Rattles on it. Gives him a clean board clear. Kind of an interesting matchup, I feel, from 6-0's perspective. You've got to be super worried about the burst, because you can't just spend an entire turn doing nothing but lay on hands if there's a board.
That's true, because basically you don't heal at all.
Yeah, you might even, it might be a negative.
Right? Yeah, you'll just take more damage
right.
The following
exactly.
By healing, yeah.
So what do you think about charging the minion right now?
I'd say that's correct. We'll have to see what the Raptor comes out with. That is a pretty decent card to use if like a Belcher comes out from 6-0.
Because the problem is like a single quality, right? It's really efficient to deal with those minions right now.
Right.
I mean, if it would be taunted up.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course, exactly. Like, whatever this board dies to, if it's taunted up or if it's charged, is the same.
I mean, Powder's got a really easy way to deal with this silenced Doomsayer in the form of the Viper, but it does look like it's going to get cleared up with the Equality Consecrate. And Powder there instantly making a note of you know, there's one of those full board clears that's been played. So now he can say, right, there's one gone, and just forget about it for now.
Second Keeper, I would say that that's the play.
I like the putting minions on the board as soon as possible, just because the Paladin is forced to answer a 2-4 afterwards.
And also Paladin.
But
60.
You might want to keep that for Belcher.
That's a good point. A Belcher might be very important to kill as soon as possible. To silence as soon as possible.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you know that you want to play the Dr. Boom next turn, right? So the Keeper is being held in the hand.
Almost no matter what. Now, here you're forcing the Paladin to have the Aldor, the Humilities, or the second Equality Clear.
The thing is, though, against Druid, even the Humility on the Dr. Boom and leaving it, it can still Savage Roar.
Right.
So, like, they're still going to do some damage. And the Paladin's on 14 now
on
turn
8. That'd
be
why he kept the Keeper, to silence the debuff.
Oh, that's a very good point. This is the
and that'll actually change everything at this
right,
point.
In this spot, it will.
Because he can't Humility and lay on hands, so I imagine it's more likely looking at Humility into just a Healbot, just a naturally safe play here.
That sounds visual.
But that's going to change everything, because the Healbot's going to heal for 8, and Powder can potentially just open back up for 7 with the Dr. Boom.
Well, he can play Humility, right? Right this then.
Oh, wow. Pyro Humility looks very appealing if you're trying to clear the board up. Lets you also play an extra 1-1 at the end of the turn, and then you can play all your healing.
The problem is, like, this is something that we saw so often during the Handlock era, right? There was a Peacekeeper on
right.
The
yeah, and then Silence.
Silence.
Black.
very. If the Boombots hit well here, there could be a.
Only 1 damage to the face, which is quite unfortunate for Powder. So but is it lethal? Wait.
Seven? I think that's legal. Wow.
And that's exactly
going to see it with the Innovate into Force of Nature.
That is it, and Powder's going to take it.
One damage was enough to seal the deal for Powder, and he is advancing to top four of the True Silver Championships.
Yeah, and there's a
congratulations.
Like, yeah!
Yeah, I did it despite the top deck True Silver champion.
And you know what? Like, I'm not surprised he's probably relieved right about now, because that was an insane set, and it was just so close every game. And the, you know, the Paladin game looking pretty good for Powder, and then just the True Silver off the top 10. They'd probably been a little bit worried, but the Druid deck made it through in the end.
Yep, that's true. And it's an not the same druid as everyone plays.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right?
It has raptors, it has the flame jugglers.
Spectral knights,
so it's something, well, maybe not, let's say, new, but it's a hybrid.
It's been, let's just say that card has been phased out of druid for the most part. It used to be super popular back in the Naxxramas era, but it's nice to see those cards being rehabilitated. Mm-hmm.